A black triangle streaks silently across the uppermost edges of the atmosphere, moving at hypersonic speeds. To an observer on the ground, it's completely invisible, except for the brief moments when it blots out the stars above, tearing through the skies at over 3,800 miles per hour. This Mach 5 Plus intruder is now entering some of the most secure airspace in the world. The object was first detected by air defense cruisers patrolling the Pacific Ocean, but only as a faint, rapidly moving radar echo. Sensitive radar struggled to maintain a lock, picking up only sporadic returns. As it drew closer to the mainland, more ocean-based air defense ships attempted to track it. With the decreasing distance, radar operators finally pieced together enough data to estimate its speed. Nearly Mach 6, nothing they knew of should be moving that fast. Across airbases in southern China, fighter jets scramble, pilots rushing to intercept an unseen intruder. Despite China's vast air defense network, they have no firm fix, only predicted flight paths based on fleeting radar echoes. But then the object maneuvers, shattering any doubts. This isn't a random anomaly. It is intelligently controlled and built to be untouchable. The unidentified flying object is no UFO, though. It's an American hypersonic bomber, the first of its kind. It's not just fast like other hypersonic bomber proposals under design around the world. It also features a breakthrough achievement: hypersonic stealth. Normally, stealth materials are too fragile to withstand more than a brief supersonic flight, as seen in aircraft like the F-35 and F-22, which are limited in their ability to sustain high speeds for extended periods. But this new bomber defies those limitations. It can maintain extreme hypersonic speeds while remaining virtually undetectable, thanks to cutting-edge metamaterials, a revolutionary advancement that reshapes the very physics of stealth and speed. The outer skin of the bomber is infused with carbon nanotubes, creating a surface where incoming radar signals become trapped. As those signals bounce around inside the nanotube structures, they lose energy with each interaction, drastically reducing the amount of radar reflection. By the time any remaining signals escape, their trajectory is completely unpredictable, with most of the wave being deflected away from the originating radar source. This not only makes detection incredibly difficult, but also disrupts radar signal integrity, ensuring the aircraft remains nearly invisible to even the most advanced tracking systems. The materials used in the bomber's construction also offer exceptional heat resistance, ensuring that neither the pilot nor the payload are cooked alive at extreme speeds. Flying at altitudes over 85,000 feet, the bomber benefits from thin air, which significantly reduces friction and heat buildup. This also makes it far more difficult to detect via infrared tracking, as the aircraft generates less thermal signature than a lower-flying hypersonic object. The bomber is equipped with a state-of-the-art electronic warfare suite designed to confuse and degrade enemy radar systems. Its own radar is so powerful that it can function as a high-intensity jammer, overwhelming the target systems of any missile or aircraft that manages to get within threatening range. Ultimately, though, the craft's speed is its best defense. Its ability to sustain hypersonic speeds and achieve great fuel efficiency means that unless a launching aircraft is very, very close, no air defense missile in the world can catch it. But while many of its capabilities are new, this is really just old hat for the US Air Force, which fielded the fastest aircraft in the world all the way back in 1964 with the SR-71 Blackbird. This isn't just an evolution of the famous spy plane, it's a brand new world of air superiority. Not only is this new aircraft more than 1,600 miles an hour faster, stealthier, and smarter, it can do something the SR-71 never could, something that's going to spell disaster for its Chinese targets. The bomber makes one last banking turn, careful not to overstress the airframe at such extreme speeds. This means that each turn takes over 100 miles to complete, but it's worth the cost in fuel in order to confuse enemy air defenses. Because in the world of hypersonic warfare, it's not just about being fast, it's about never being where the enemy expects you to be. The target is finally coming into range, a massive new defense complex built directly into the mountainside. Similar to America's famous Cheyenne Mountain facility, this installation is even more ambitious. In fact, it is 10 times larger than the Pentagon and serves as the beating heart of the Chinese military, coordinating strategic operations, intelligence, and national defense. Buried deep under tons of rock and located far inland, the facility is designed to be virtually indestructible. Under normal circumstances, only a nuclear weapon could pose a real threat to its reinforced command structure. But tonight, something far more precise is coming. The US will do it with just two aircraft. Hot on the heels of America's hypersonic intruder is a sister ship, following a different flight path with the same ultimate goal. The attack has already caught China completely off guard. While Chinese intelligence was aware that the US was developing a hypersonic bomber, they never expected it to be operational this soon. What shocked them even more was the unprecedented speed of development. The ability to convert prototype aircraft directly into fully functional combat-ready models, This breakthrough shaved years off the expected timeline, allowing the US to field a weapon long before China believed it was possible. This represents yet another leapfrog in American aerospace technology. Aggressive use of realistic 3D modeling, thanks to increasingly powerful supercomputers, means that engineers can test an aircraft in ways never possible before. Typically, a new weapons program, such as a new fighter or bomber aircraft, would require years of development and the building of a prototype. It would then go through years of rigorous testing of ever more advanced prototypes as capabilities are added on, scaled up, or scaled down, depending on the test results. Most of this can be achieved digitally now, cutting development time down from the usual 20 or so years to less than 10. This is the secret behind the rapid development of America's latest non-hypersonic stealth bomber, the B-21 Raider. Unlike traditional programs where prototypes serve purely as test platforms, the first B-21 prototype is expected to be combat-coded and eventually join the fleet as the first operational bomber of the program. America's new hypersonic bomber doesn't just catch enemies off guard with its speed. It catches them off guard with its speed of development, leaving them with no time to develop proper counters or defenses. The two bombers, codenamed Medusa 1 and Medusa 2, approach their target from different directions, just 20 miles southwest of Beijing. The sprawling military complex covers 1,500 acres and features offices, garages, and even shopping centers and restaurants, everything senior military members and their staff need to live on site as long as possible. Deep underground is the heart of the facility, though, the very nerve center of the Chinese military, from where the nation's armed forces can be coordinated in times of both conventional and nuclear war. Beijing Military City, as it's known, is supposed to withstand a direct nuclear strike. The US will be putting those claims to the test. When it was first developed, the SR-71 was originally envisioned as capable of carrying both air-to-air and air-to-ground weapons. This would give the US Air Force the capability to rapidly engage incoming Soviet bombers carrying nuclear weapons far from US shores, and having a Mach 3 capable bomber would allow American forces to rapidly respond to targets of opportunity with limited engagement windows. However, deploying weapons from a Mach 3 aircraft posed significant challenges, and those challenges became even greater when attempting to launch a weapon from an aircraft traveling at over 5 times the speed of sound. The technical hurdles were so immense that many experts originally believed it to be impossible. The basic problem is that any hypersonic aircraft would have to carry weapons internally. Even sleek missiles would introduce drag and aerodynamic forces on the aircraft that would threaten its safety. When you're flying at over 3,500 miles per hour, the air in effect becomes a blowtorch, scorching surfaces to around 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. This means bombs and missiles would need to withstand those temperatures for hours. But an even greater danger for the aircraft is the turbulence created when its carefully engineered hypersonic shape is disrupted by protruding ordnance hanging from the wings or belly. Then there is, of course, the stealth consideration. The only option is to carry weapons internally. And for a long time, that's exactly what made the concept of a hypersonic fighter or bomber impossible. The moment that a hypersonic aircraft opens its bay doors, it's immediately changing the way air flows over it, with potentially catastrophic results. Not only is flight stability an issue, but the air can also enter the bay and damage internal components like sensitive electronics. It could even act as an air brake if there's no way of allowing the air to pass through the bay. This would lead to disastrous results for the aircraft. Have you ever tapped the brakes for a moment when going down the freeway in order to cause your buddy to lurch forward uncontrollably? Imagine that, but at Mach 6. First, the bay doors themselves need to be constructed out of material that is not just strong enough to withstand extreme heating, but also the brute force of suddenly changing airflow. If the doors are too weak or experience melting, they could simply be torn off. The result would be a catastrophic redirection of airflow across the body of the aircraft, causing it to tear itself to pieces. The shock of being lowered into the hypersonic airstream means that the bomb bay doors need to be one of the strongest parts of the aircraft. But the doors and the bay itself also need to be specifically designed so as to properly manage a shift in airflow. It's easy to build a shape that can tolerate hypersonic flight. It's a lot harder to create a craft that can change shapes at hypersonic speeds without destroying itself. Even with the bomb bay problem solved, simply firing a weapon at hypersonic speeds is yet another migraine-inducing set of problems. The most obvious problem with this is that you're having to take an object, a bomb or a missile, that's sheltered from hypersonic wind, and then suddenly introduce it to a hypersonic airflow. If you tried to drop a bomb the normal way, simply detaching it and letting gravity pull it out of the bomb bay, the results could be disastrous. But even if the weapon successfully enters the airstream, the unpredictable turbulence at hypersonic speeds presents another major problem. The bomb would be violently tossed around, likely spinning out of control, breaking apart midair, or being thrown so far off course that by the time it regained stability, it would be completely useless as a precision weapon. The solution that American designers came up with all the way back in the 1960s was simple and yet ingenious. They simply introduced the bomb or missile to the supersonic airstream while still under control of the aircraft. To achieve this, they developed a trapeze-like system that would extend a weapon out of the bomb bay and insert it into the airstream. This allowed the weapon to enter the airstream in a controlled manner and to remain under control until it's released. A powerful rocket engine would then push the weapon away from the aircraft and put it en route to its target. The trapeze system was developed as far back as the 1960s and proved so effective that the US considered integrating it with a nuclear-tipped air-to-ground missile. This concept would have allowed a variant of the A-12, known as the YF-12, to neutralize Soviet air defenses long before conventional nuclear bombers reached their targets. It was also envisioned as a high-speed interceptor, carrying a loadout of AIM-47 air-to-air missiles, giving it the ability to destroy Soviet bombers and even fighter aircraft before they even knew what hit them. To date, a trapeze launch system has only been successfully used at Mach 2 plus speeds, far below the Mach 5 plus conditions that DARPA's new hypersonic bomber is designed to operate in. It seems, however, that DARPA's engineers are confident it can in fact be done. Medusa 1 and Medusa 2 approach Beijing Military City from different vectors, sowing even more confusion among the Chinese air defense forces. Still within several hundred miles from their target, the bombers begin their attack run. They slow down by a few hundred miles an hour, still well above Mach 5 and out of reach of Chinese fighters desperately trying to catch them. Noting the gravity of the danger, several of the Chinese interceptors have completely exhausted their fuel in a futile attempt to catch the American craft. They're either forced to eject or try to glide to a safe landing at an alternate field nearby. 200 miles away, Medusa 1 and Medusa 2 open their bomb bay doors. The shock of the bay doors entering the hypersonic airstream sends a shudder through the aircraft, and yet they hold. Now, though, the bombers are at their most vulnerable. They're moving slower than usual, and the open bay doors means their radar defeating properties are hugely compromised. This is the best chance a Chinese fighter or air defense battery is going to get to shoot one of the American intruders down. Several missiles begin screaming toward the bombers. Hot on the heels of the bomb bay doors opening, a specially designed trapeze system lowers two large missiles into the hypersonic airstream, producing a shockwave that causes the aircraft to shudder. Small fins on the missiles help stabilize the bombs, and after a series of internal checks by the onboard computer that take less than a second, the missiles are released. The missiles are powered by scramjets, a unique type of engine with no moving parts. Instead of relying on turbines or compressors, scramjets use the shape of the engine itself to compress supersonic airflow as it moves through the system. Once the highly compressed air is mixed with fuel, combustion occurs, generating a powerful thrust without the need for traditional mechanical components. While simple scramjets have been tested as far back as the mid-1950s, they have historically had limited practical use due to one major drawback. They only work at supersonic speeds. That means they need to be launched from an already high-speed platform to be effective. The hypersonic bomber itself utilizes scramjets, though it's fielding a new type of engine altogether. Known as a turbine-based combined cycle or TBCC propulsion system, the bomber's two engines physically transform in different flight regimes to operate at maximum efficiency across different speeds. On the ground, they work much like a conventional jet engine, which uses turbofans to compress air before igniting it. But once achieving supersonic speeds, they transition to scramjet mode by physically transforming themselves while at full operation. The missiles are lighter than the bomber and need to survive hypersonic speeds for less time, so they lurch forward and within seconds they're screaming along at Mach 12. The big boost they get from starting their launch at Mach 5 plus, though, doesn't just allow them to save fuel, it adds directly to their lethality. Each missile is fired simultaneously to avoid an unbalanced airflow that would destroy the launching bomber. However, the missiles themselves are programmed to fly at slightly different speeds. The lead missile reaches its target at speeds in excess of Mach 12, using its scramjet and gravity to propel itself. The second missile reaches its target at a fraction of a second later, at a slightly lower speed. The weapons are so precise that the second missile actually enters the crater caused by the first missile. The first missile impacts the ground but doesn't detonate. Rather, its extreme speed propels it hundreds of feet into the earth. The inner core of the missile is constructed from extremely tough materials, designed to withstand the immense forces of hypersonic impact. Its purpose isn't just to survive the initial strike, but to penetrate hundreds of feet into the earth before detonating with its full payload. The first explosion is not meant to destroy the target outright. Instead, it loosens and destabilizes the ground, weakening the layers of rock and reinforced defenses above the bunker. A fraction of a second later, a second missile follows, Taking advantage of the weakened structure, this one plows even deeper, detonating just dozens of feet from the deepest point of the Chinese bunker. The resulting shockwave is specifically designed to collapse underground structures, creating a man-made earthquake. But the attack isn't over. Missiles 3 and 4 are precisely targeted to exploit the earthquake-like effect triggered by the first two strikes. Arriving just a second later, they hammer into the weakened ground, compounding the devastation. The earth roars as the second wave of impacts sends shockwaves rippling through the underground complex. The sheer force of the blast collapses the tunnels, buries command centers, and kills hundreds of senior Chinese military officials. While the bunker isn't completely destroyed, its command structure is crippled, leaving what was once China's most secure military facility in ruins. As a warning to Iran, the United States carried out a real-world attack using conventional deep-penetration munitions against Houthi underground bunkers. The exact methods remain classified, but under former President Biden's orders, B-2 bombers destroyed 5 underground facilities storing weapons, rockets, and supplies. The message was clear: Iran, which has built extensive underground facilities for its aircraft and missiles, is not untouchable. The U.S. demonstrated that even heavily fortified, deeply buried targets can be neutralized. The attacks are a success. Medusa 1 and Medusa 2 accelerate past Mach 6, streaking out of enemy missile range before China's defenses can react. To further confuse and evade Chinese air defenses, both bombers take separate escape routes. Medusa 1 heads north en route to a friendly airfield, while Medusa 2 veers out to sea, making its way toward the U.S. base in Okinawa. The revolutionary nature of these aircraft is not just their ability to carry out strikes anywhere in the world at extreme speeds, but the ability to sortie out again with a short turnaround. Whereas aircraft such as the B-2 bomber require a lengthy turnaround time for maintenance, these new hypersonic bombers can be put back into the fight much more quickly. This is partly due to advances in materials technology, but also thanks to the simplicity of the scramjet configuration that the two engines operate in for most of the aircraft's mission. Rather than waiting days or longer for redeployment, Medusa 1 and Medusa 2 are ready to return to the fight almost immediately. This capability revolutionizes modern warfare. Targets that previously had only a few-hour window of vulnerability are now within reach at any moment. The U.S. can hold any enemy at risk anywhere in the world at any time, without warning. What do you think about the U.S. military's new hypersonic bomber? Could this game-changing technology reshape modern warfare, or will other nations develop countermeasures just as quickly? Let us know your thoughts in the comments below. Now check out the B-21 vs. B-2. Which stealth fighter is deadlier? Or click this other video instead.